evening. I'm Nancy Cutler. I'm president of the Jewish Museum of Maryland, and it's my pleasure to welcome you tonight to the first ever socially distanced and completely virtual members opening. As most of you will know from openings which we've had in the past, we normally would be gathering together in the lobby of the museum, greeting one another with hugs, sharing the buffet, and perusing the exhibit. But unfortunately, the coronavirus has kept us from doing that kind of an opening this evening. But I will say that our team at the museum has done its very best job to simulate the impact of what our traditional openings are like. It all began with the first and probably most important thing, and that was to recruit a fantastic speaker. And I think you will all find that Marc Okrand's story is fascinating. And if the post office was kind to each of us this past week, most of you should have received a little package with some treats to help put the spirit of tonight's event in context. I hope you can see some of the decorations I've used behind me. We also again, hope you received some of the fun little Jewish Museum gelt and some fantastic postcards, which really highlight many of the things in the exhibit. If for some reason you have not received your packet, please email Trillian Atwood at the address that's now being placed in the chat box, and she'll make sure to get one of these fun little goodie bags to you. I want to just take a minute to thank all of those who have made this exhibit possible, beginning with the Center for Jewish History in New York, which developed the original concept for the exhibit. And of course, to the JMM staff, the team led by Marvin, Tracy Guy Decker, and Joanna Church, who with the help of the designer, our designer, Danielle McKimkin, and the exhibit builder, Mark Ward, created the Maryland edition of this exhibition. The Maryland presentation of this exhibit has been made possible in part by the generous support of a gift in memory of Patrick J. Kelly Jr., a Baltimore Science Fiction Society founder, the Joseph and Harvey Meyerhoff Family Charitable Funds, PNC Greater Maryland, Larry Boltansky. Additional funding has come from the Greif Family Fund, the Cutler Family Philanthropic Fund, the Kaplan Kronsberg Family Charitable Fund, a gift in memory of Jim Guy, Emily Schwab and family in memory of James Schwab, Harriet Stillman, Philip Tolkoff, Julian H. Krolik and Elaine F. Weiss Philanthropic Fund, Annette and Michael Saxon Fund, and Moog Music. If you'd like to learn more about how you can join the long list of JMM project supporters, please reach out to Tracy Dorfman at the address now being placed in the chat. And finally, there's one organization that stands behind everything we do here at JMM, and we are very proud of the support we receive from the Associated Jewish Community Federation. And now I'm going to turn things over to Marvin to get this party started.
Thank you, Nancy. Well, this Halloween weekend, you could have spent your time with things that are truly scary: pandemics caused by alien microbes, dystopian political scenarios, or on a planet where greedy entrepreneurs are destroying the environment. Instead, you've made the right choice to join us in the Star Trek universe, a place where even galactic threats can be solved in 55 minutes, except for the two-part episodes. If there is anyone in this audience who is unfamiliar with the Star Trek canon as it has evolved over the past 55 years and has become the subject of 9 television series, 13 movies, and hundreds of novels and short stories, I have to ask, where have you been hiding? But just to recap, the story begins on the Starship Enterprise of the beneficial United Federation of Planets, sort of like the Jewish Federation, but with no phonathons. The principal geopolitical rival of the Federation in the original series is the Klingon Empire. In subsequent series, the Klingons ally with the Federation, and there's even a Klingon member of the Enterprise crew, Worf. Worf is just one of dozens of characters in the Star Trek universe trying to navigate between his ethnic or species identity and the values and culture of the human crew with whom he works. Many Star Trek stories revolve around characters like Spock, Data, Odo, and Seven of Nine, struggling with issues of assimilation and the way that they stand out or fit in with colleagues from other worlds. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? To make these stories plausible, the aliens need more than prosthetics and makeup. They need their own culture. And what's a culture without a language? Which takes us to tonight's very special guest, Marc Okrand. Dr. Okrand earned his bachelor's degree in linguistics at the University of California, Santa Cruz, going on to do his doctoral thesis at Berkeley on an extinct Native American language. He is a postdoctoral fellowship with the Smithsonian Institution. In the 1980s, he joined the National Captioning Institute, where he worked on the first closed captioning system for hearing impaired television viewers and was the director of live captioning at the Institute. He also began work in the 1980s on the Star Trek franchise, helping over a span of 30 years to develop Vulcan and Romulan languages, as well as Klingon. Asking questions of Dr. Okrand tonight will be JMM's own deputy director and project manager for the Jews in Space exhibit, Tracy Guy Decker. And Tracy is certainly a lady of many hats, and this is one of the more unusual ones. In Yiddish, you congratulate someone by wishing them mazel tov, which literally means good constellations. But I think the more appropriate word of encouragement for an evening when the stars are already aligned is the Klingon, kapla, success.
Thanks, Marvin. You gave us a little bit of a spoiler. That's okay. Thank you so much, Marvin. Again, I am Tracy Guy Decker, and I'm actually going to ask you all if you did put up your decorations like I did, please take a picture of it at some point during the evening and then email that picture to Laura Grant. We are going to be keep this celebration going over the next week. So before we get started, though, I'm not going to say where have you been the way Marvin just did, but before we actually start talking to Mark, I thought maybe we should share a brief clip of someone actually speaking Klingon, this alien language, one of the alien languages that that Mark invented. So Trillian, can you give us this clip from Star Trek Deep Space Nine, please?
I think I know why I love you. Let's go to the medical ward.
And it's of course laid in.
Mark, what did we just hear? What did it mean?
That was like a song to go off to war or something like that. They were talking about Kalis, who's the sort of founder of the Klingon Empire. They said, oh, here's sons of Kalis, here's daughters of Kalis. The blood of battle washes clean, and so on and so on. Very Klingon-y kinds of things to say.
So
adventure writing that song, the lyrics are mine. I can tell you about that later.
You know, it's, I know for you it's a common request, but I can't imagine that it's a common request of a linguist to create a new language for a science fiction TV show. So how did they find you? I trust they didn't look you up in the yellow pages.
It was accident. They found me for Klingon because a couple of years before that I did Vulcan. So the real question is, how did they find me to do Vulcan? And the way they found me for Vulcan is because at the time I was doing closed captioning, as was mentioned earlier. And when we first started, we could only do shows that were on film or on tape, where they could send us the tape ahead of time when we could look at them and pause the tape, type in what they said, hit go, little hear a little more, pause the tape, type in, and so on. But we couldn't do anything live. And we finally figured out how to do live programs like the news and sports. And we decided the first program that we did that we announced to the world we were going to caption live should be a show with high publicity value, but relatively low probability of error. So we picked the Oscars. The high publicity value was obvious because the Oscars were shown, Oscars are shown all around the world. The low probability of error is, to give out a dirty little secret that everybody knows anyway, is the Oscars are scripted, right? The actors don't get up there and say, the job of the sound engineer is to this, making that up off the top of their heads. That's all scripted. The show is legit. They don't know who's gonna win. So the only part that we thought we'd have to do really, really live is, and the Oscar goes to so-and-so, and I'd like to thank my mother and father and acting coach and all that. And the whole rest of the thing could be in the computer ahead of time. So we proposed that to the powers that be, the Academy or whoever it was. And they said, that's a great idea. We'll give you a script. But the script keeps changing. Someone has to keep track of all the changes because the closer it gets to airtime, the more and more changes there are. And for some reason or other, I was given the job of keeping track of the script. So they flew me out to Los Angeles. I arrived on a Sunday night, maybe Monday morning, called up whoever I was supposed to call. They said, great, welcome to Hollywood. We'll have something for you on Thursday. So I had Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday with nothing to do, which was okay with me. And I grew up in Los Angeles, that's home. So my family knew I was going to be there, but I hadn't called any of my friends. This is pre-email, pre-cell phones and everything. But I got on the phone and called some friends and said, hey, I'm in town, let's have dinner, let's have lunch. And one of my friends said, where are you right now? So I said where I was. She said, oh, that's like a mile from here. Why don't you come by for lunch? Okay. Well, where she was where she works, which is Paramount Pictures. She was the assistant to the executive producer of Star Trek II, that movie, which was in post-production. And I knew that she was working on Star Trek, and I knew the producer as well. In fact, his name was Harve Bennett. He'd just finished actually producing a woman called Golda, about Golda Meir, with also had Leonard Nimoy in it. Anyway, but that's all I knew. I didn't know anything more about the Star Trek thing than that. So we're having lunch, and the topic of linguistics came up. And they told me, another woman who was working on the show was sitting there, that they'd been talking to the linguistics department at UCLA because there was a scene in the movie where Mr. Spock and a Vulcan character, a new character named Savik, have a short little conversation. And when they filmed it, they were speaking English. But now that they're editing the film, they thought it would make much more sense if they were speaking Vulcan. So they got the idea of hiring a linguist from UCLA to come over, watch the scene, look at the lips and basically make up gobbledygook that sounded different but matched the lip movements. And I told him I thought that was a really smart idea and that a wise way to go, and a linguist could do a good job. And they said, yeah, we thought it was a good idea too, but it's turned into be a headache. And now this is 30 lots of years ago. I don't remember what the headache was, but it was a boring headache. I had a phone tag or something. She says, I don't know what we're gonna do. We have to have this taken care of right away. And I said, what do you mean right away? She says, it's got to be done by the end of this week, which is exactly how long I was in town for the Oscars. So I said, I can do that. And my friend said, yeah, he can do that. He's got the same kind of degrees as those people at UCLA do. At that point, the associate producer walked by. They said, hey, we just solved the Vulcan problem. He said, what are you talking about? So they told him. And he said, come see me after lunch. And that's how it happened. Now, the fact that I knew Harv, the producer, the main producer, is not irrelevant. So it's not like he was hiring someone he never heard of. But I didn't go there to make up a language. I went there to get a sandwich, you know.
And you did it. You made up gobbledygook that matched the language.
Yeah.
I think Chilean has it. So I think Chilean has the scene queued up. Can we take a look at it?
Sure.
Ich bin Gomi. Ich bin
Gomi.
Ich bin Gomi. Ich bin Gomi.
That's not what they said in English. So, yeah.
Yeah, the actual words were just gobbledygook, you said.
But yeah, well, they were just saying gobbledygook. Yeah, yeah, and they changed the original subtitles don't quite match what the original English was either, for two reasons. One is to throw you off, so you don't get how it was done. And the other is they did this at all for two reasons. Well, three reasons. One is, why aren't Vulcans speaking Vulcan to each other? Another one is because they changed one line of dialogue because it didn't make sense anymore. After they edited the film, the tense was wrong.
Oh.
Okay, so they figured the easiest way to fix it instead of shooting it all over again was to make gibberish and put in a subtitle. And another reason they changed is because they cut out a little bit of conversation that comes right after that, which is Spock telling Savik, who's new to the scene, how they're Vulcans and they don't quite fit in. It's what we were talking about a little bit earlier already tonight. They don't quite fit in, so she should learn how to deal with that appropriately. But they cut that chunk of dialogue out for some reason or other. And they thought one way to get the idea that these people are outsiders, in addition to having pointy ears, was to have them speak a different language from everybody else, which is a very clever and subtle way of doing that.
Yeah, interesting. And speaking of folks, outsiders speaking a different language, many have noted that Klingon and Yiddish sound a little bit similar.
Which reminds me, yeah, when I went to work with them, I had to work with the actors to get them to say this gobbledygook. And it was on two different days. So the first day I worked with the woman, Savik, who is Kirstie Alley, which is one of her first jobs in Hollywood. And on the way to the soundstage, the associate producer said, you know, in the first Star Trek movie, which was a couple of years before that, they spoke a little bit of Vulcan. And I said, yeah. He said, your language should sound like that. He told me that after I'd already made up the whole lip syncing thing. He said, let's go watch that. So make sure that your sound language sounds like that language. I'm thinking, oh my God, what am I going to do? Because I already did it.
Yeah.
So we looked at the scene and I'm listening. What do I hear that I could kind of sprinkle in there that you cannot see on the lips so that I don't have to do it all over again? And what I was hearing in the original Vulcan in that movie was every once in a while, that sound. Mm-hmm. I said, good, I'll put a few of those in because you can't see them. So I sprinkled a few in and I go and work with Kirstie Alley and we're practicing and practicing. And the director of the film, a guy named Nick Meyer, pulls the producer aside and he said, I don't know if this Vulcan is gonna work. And the producer said, why, what's the matter? And Nick said, I don't think Vulcan should sound like Yiddish. And of course, what he was hearing was that hadn't even been there before. And the producer said, well, let's try it, you know. And if we don't like it, we'll do something else. And Nick said, okay. So we did it and he liked it. So just saw happened, right. And then yeah. I went back, that was a Tuesday or something. And then I went back on, I remember it was a Friday to work with Leonard Nimoy. And I got to the place on time. Right. I got there on time. The engineer got there on time. Whoever brings the donuts got there on time. And Leonard Nimoy got there on time, but there's nobody else. And I'm in a room all by myself with me and Mr. Spock and donuts. And I knew who he was. He didn't know who I am. And so I introduced myself. Oh, yeah, they told me you were going to be here. Show me what I have to do. So I showed him the lines. And he said, now, if I change this to this, will that still work as far as the lips go? And I said, yeah. Okay, that'll be easier. Let me do that. If I change this to that, will that work? No, okay, we'll leave it alone, you know. And we practiced and he did his lines and then we were done. And I left, and at that point I had Oscar work to do. So I'm driving to where the Oscars were and realized that I had just taught Mr. Spock how to speak Vulcan. And I thought that was pretty great. You know, that's a great thing for a linguist to do.
That is pretty great. So Vulcan shouldn't sound like Yiddish, but Klingon sort of does, but not intentionally, maybe?
Not intentionally, yeah.
But it does. And so I thought we would do something maybe a little fun with the audience. So y'all, we're gonna do a little quiz. So basically I'm gonna ask Marc to say a word and then you all are gonna see a poll with different options for what it might mean in English or in Yiddish. So Marc, take it away.
Okay, the word is kapla, kapla.
Okay, what do you think it means, y'all? Okay, so you guys were paying attention when Marvin was talking. You are right. It means success in Klingon. So, and we are going to try one more round. Okay. Marc, you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's another hear it. One. Machaya. Machaya.
All right, y'all, this one didn't have a spoiler from the beginning. So let's see how well you do when Marvin hasn't given it away. Give it just another minute. All right, let's see what our audience thinks. Okay, so you all know your Yiddish and Klingon. You are right. Good job. There's another word that I understand is pretty similar between the two languages that we chose not to include in a poll because they sound very, very similar. And it's a word that I actually say all the time. So tell me, Marc, what does oi mean in Klingon?
There's a Klingon word, oi, it's kind of oi, which means pain or ache or something. And that one I did on purpose. That one I took from Yiddish on purpose as a joke, yeah.
Okay, great. All right. So as you heard earlier in our introduction, since we couldn't bring our guests to the party, we sent party to them. And so many members of the audience this evening received a party in a bag in the mail. And inside it, there is a dreidel inspired by astronaut Dr. Jeffrey Hoffman, who took a dreidel to space. And apparently it's spun for hours in weightlessness. And so I was going to ask you how to say dreidel in Klingon, but in a bit of internet rabbit hole following, I mean, research, we did discover that someone has already translated it. So the internet says that the way to say dreidel in Klingon is dingul. I didn't say it right, huh?
I didn't say it right.
What is it? How to say it for us.
It's dingwit. Dingwit. Dingwit.
Awesome. And do you agree that is the right way to?
That's a good, spinner, something that spins. Yeah.
Spinner. Okay. So spinner is a substitute for dreidel or savivon, which actually is a good, spinner. And there's actually we have a fan-made video that illustrates a similar substitution of spinner for dreidel. So let's take a look at this clip of a Klingon translation of a famous Jewish-themed musical, which is also happens to be in Lego.
It's really good. Whoever did this, okay. a guy named Terry did this. It's brilliant. The little animation is fun, which you didn't get to see much of. And the translation is really good. Yes.
Awesome.
The title of A Fiddler on the Roof, there's no word for fiddler.
Right. So strummer.
And it's a strummer. Yes. Someone who's the literal title of that he used is Bebdak Bat Yachwit, which means a strummer sits on the roof, something like that.
Nice. So spinners, strummers, there's this whole canon of works out there that are written in or translated into Klingon that actually aren't your work. There's the four questions in Klingon, which are actually in our exhibit, the four questions from the Haggadah.
Let me tell you a story about that while you mentioned it. Okay. The last real Seder I was at, because this year was strange.
A Zoom Seder, right?
I was not the youngest person there, but I was given the opportunity, if that's the right word, to ask the four questions.
And you asked them in Klingon.
So I asked the four questions in Klingon, but the answers were given in Yiddish.
Okay. So the four questions from the Haggadah. There is also, I understand, Hamlet and other Shakespearean works that are being restored to their original Klingon versions per the claim in the movie Star Trek VI. That you haven't experienced Shakespeare until you hear it in the original Klingon. And I understand there is a play by a Dutch acting troupe inspired by the Klingon Hamlet, and another that you told me about that sounds really fascinating in Klingon English and Swedish. So how do you feel about the fact that your creation is out there living a life of its own?
I think it's great. I never thought that would happen. You know, when I did the original little bit of Vulcan, I thought that maybe I would be a footnote in a trivia book one day. Mm-hmm. That would be the end of it.
And now there are trivia books about you.
And even when I made up the Klingon for the film, for Star Trek III is the one where the Klingon came up. I thought I was just making up lines of dialogue for the film and that's all. But what happened is during the course of filmmaking, I was there for about a month. Well, they're filming. So in almost every scene in Star Trek III where you see someone speaking Klingon, I'm just out of the frame.
Just out of frame.
But most of the time. because I'm working with the actors up to the last second. Say it again. And the crew, the filmmaking crew, was very interested in all this language stuff. So they would come up to me and say, how do you say this and how do you say that? So I got the idea, you know, if this film crew, who's kind of jaded, they're Hollywood people, they've seen everything.
Right.
If they're interested, there's a kind of person who I'd heard about but didn't really know yet, called a Star Trek fan. They might be interested too. So I proposed the idea of writing a book explaining how the language works. And the powers that be said, yeah, do that. So I did. And it sold. Now, when you write a book, you hope people will buy it, right?
And
look at it. And I thought what would happen is people would buy it and they'd look at it and kind of thumb through it. Say, oh, look, you know, here's the Klingon word for shoe. Ha, ha, ha. You know, and leave it on their coffee table and every once in a while pick it up. But what happened is people bought it and read it and reread it and studied it and compiled a list of the typos. And all of a sudden there's a language community, a language speaking community out there that I didn't even know was there until it had been going for several years.
So,
and they're the ones who are doing all these things.
So what's the most interesting or impressive example of a Klingon language creation
that's
created?
Shakespeare certainly is pretty good. The first one they did was Hamlet because of that line in Star Trek VI. Mm-hmm. Because after he says you can't really appreciate Shakespeare until you've read the original Klingon, the thing that happens right after that is a Klingon says tach 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 bet, which means to be or not to be.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I made up that line, but I didn't make up any of the other lines in the translation of Hamlet. The fans did that. Actually, making up to be or not to be was kind of a challenge, now that I think about it, because the script for Star Trek VI was sprinkled with Klingon, sprinkled with Shakespeare.
Mm.
Some of the lines were in English, some of the lines were in Klingon. Over time, during the process of filmmaking, it's noise in the street here, welcome to downtown.
Yeah.
All the Klingon Shakespeare lines got eliminated. The English ones stayed, the Klingon ones got cut out. Because when you make a movie, it changes every day anyway, so I didn't think much of it. But one day I arrived on the set, and the director says, oh, I need one more line in Klingon. This is Nick Meyer again, the same guy from The Vulcan.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, okay, what's that? And he said, to be or not to be. And I said, okay. But I thought, oh no. Because when I wrote the book, one of the things I say in there is that in Klingon, there's no verb to be.
Mm.
So all like I had was or and not. And I couldn't change it because it's in the book, right?
Yeah.
And I didn't want to change it anyway. So I said, what if it's to live or not to live? And Nick says, the director says, yeah, that's fine. Go, that's good. Go tell Chris. Now, Chris is Christopher Plummer, who's the actor who had to say the line. And the way to say live, to live or not to live, there's a number of different ways to do it. But the way I did it was kind of simple, which was live or live not. The word for live is yin. All these words are in the dictionary. I'm stuck with them. Yin, or is par, not is bet. So it's live or live not. Yin, par, yin, bet. So I go to Christopher Plummer. Christopher Plummer says, how do you say this line? I said, yin pa, yin bet. And he said, no, that's too wimpy. That's not what he said, but that's what he meant. So I said, oh my God, now what am I going to do? So I thought about it. And I said, well, what if we say tach? He says, say the whole thing. Tach pa, tach bet. He goes, tach. Tach is good. We'll keep tach. Up until that moment, tach was a suffix that meant to continue doing whatever the verb is. So eat plus tach means keep on eating, right? I kind of promoted it to be a verb in its own right. That means to go on, to continue, to endure. So tach, pach, tach, bet, to go on or not to go on, to continue
that
or not to continue.
Right? Is brilliant. That's a brilliant translation of the Shakespeare. Because it's more than just living.
So when they picked, when they decided to do Hamlet first, they had a head start. They had that one line. But the reason I think it's so brilliant and the other stuff they've done too is because the parts of Hamlet that are written, I shouldn't say this because they're originally in Klingon, the parts of Hamlet that we see in English, hear in English in prose are in Klingon prose. And the parts that are in poetry are in Klingon iambic pentameter. It's just
amazing,
brilliant the way they did it.
Oh, tell the story about the grave diggers. and about the choices made with the Gravedigger.
There's a Gravedigger scene in Hamlet, which comes right before Alas, Poor Yorick, right? And there's two Gravediggers talking to each other. And in the way the English Shakespeare version is, they're talking in a very strange dialect of English. It's not the regular English like the rest of the play is. So presumably they're talking a strange dialect of Danish, I guess. Anyway, and what they're saying is one pun after another. So when the translators got to that part, they said, well, what do? We have to make a decision here. Because if we translate the dialogue as it is, there's no more puns. So is Shakespeare trying to say what the lines mean, or is he trying to play with the puns? And they decided the puns were more important. So they rewrote the entire dialogue, and it's one Klingon pun after another in a strange dialect of Klingon.
That's so great. I love that. So I have another question, and then I'm going to open it up to, so you've got the ambulance, I've got the dogs. I'm going to open it up to the audience. And by the way, folks, put your questions in the Q&A function at the bottom to make sure that I get them so that I can share them with Marc. But so you all should know who are watching, whenever we do an event like this, I always, in the prep, I always ask the guest if there's something that I should ask. And so when I asked you that question, Marc, you told me to make sure that I ask, what members of the Klingon language fandom do after they've learned the language?
Yeah,
so what do they do?
The ones who learn it really, really well. When they get together, very often, a handful of them, you know, 3, 4, 5 of them, will do what's called taking the vow. And that is, they determine that for a period of 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, whatever they choose, they will speak no language to anybody other than Klingon. And by anybody, that means hotel workers, wait staff at a restaurant, nobody, okay? And if there's 3 or 4 vow takers who are all together and they have to communicate with someone who doesn't know any Klingon at all, then they resort to, you know, mime and pointing and things like that. But sometimes there was someone who has not taken the vow, but is absolutely fluent in Klingon, and that person serves as the translator, okay? So one time, a group of people went out to lunch, and let's just narrow it down to 2 people. One of the two took the vow and would speak to nobody in anything other than Klingon, and would respond actually to nothing other than if you spoke Klingon to him. And another one didn't take the vow, so he was the translator. So they went to lunch, they went to the restaurant, and the one who took the vow said that he wanted to eat something, and he said in Klingon what it was he wanted to eat, and the translator translated it to the waiter, the waitress. And then the waiter said, that comes on either a plate or as a sandwich, which would you prefer? There's no Klingon word for sandwich. So the translator had to figure out, how am I going to say that in Klingon and get the right answer? So what he said was, I should point out, because this is very relevant, that both of these two guys were Jewish. In fact, the one who's the translator used to wear a kippah that had Klingon writing on it. He said, the word for a plate that you eat off for dinner, is jengvat, is a plate. So jengvat danech'a means, do you want a plate? So he asked that. Or par. We've all learned par because it's the same par as to be or not to be.
Right.
Par. All right. So, Jeng Bat Banecha, do you want a plate? Par. Or he said, Chilel Danecha. Chilel was a word no one's ever heard before in Klingon, but the other guy understood immediately that he was referring to a sandwich because of the whole thing with Chilel and making
a Chilel sandwich on Passover
and all that stuff. Yeah.
That is fantastic and so appropriate for this group. So I have to tell you all, I had heard several of these stories before when Marc and I met to prep for this, but he intentionally didn't tell me that story to make sure that I would react to it. Well done. Well played, sir. Well played. So I have plenty more questions, and we do have a couple of questions in the question and answer. Michael Saxon wants to know, how did you go about building the lexicon, like building the vocabulary when you wrote the book and just thinking through the language?
Yeah. Well, originally it was easy because I was making up lines for a movie and I thought that's all I was doing. So I just made up enough vocabulary that so I could translate all the just lines in the movie.
Yeah.
And I made up more vocabulary than what ended up in the movie, because when you make a movie, they cut stuff out. Oops, I knew that was gonna happen. All right, hold on.
Whoever has that on your bingo card.
It's gone. So I made up all the words that were in the original script for the movie, whether they ended up in the movie or not.
Right.
So I didn't have to think about what should be in the vocabulary. But when I started to write the book, I put in all the words that were in the movie, and all the words that had, I went back to the original Star Trek series, TV series, and pulled out words from the episodes that had Klingons in them and made up words for that. And I made a decision that I wasn't gonna make up any more words that had anything to do with Klingon culture or Klingon geography, which is odd to not put those in, except for the ones that were already there because of the movie or the TV show. But the reason I didn't do it is because I'm not a script writer. And I didn't want to make up stuff and then have a scriptwriter come, you know, several years later and say something that contradicted that. I said, let them make it up and I'll tell them how to say it.
That's fascinating. So you very intentionally chose not to engage in world building. You
right.
Doing at language time. Building.
But I made it, but I still put in lots of kind of neutral kinds of everyday words. Mm-hmm. I've changed my mind about that over the years. So I've made up all kinds of things having to do with Klingon culture, you know, since then. But that was my rule at the beginning. A few years ago, now it's maybe even 10 years ago, there was a project in England. They produced a CD-ROM or whatever kind of disc you put in a computer, a DVD, whatever it was, a language learning thing. And this company has a series for lots of different languages, French and Spanish and Swahili and all kinds of stuff. And they wanted to do one for Klingon. But they use the same words for all the different languages. So whether you're learning, want to learn French or Spanish or whatever, it's all the same words. And I thought, well, this is silly, because all the words are, you know, Western culture.
Right, right,
words,
right.
Not Klingon words. So how's that going to work? But they said, do it anyway. So I did, and, you know, I had to make up Klingon words for everyday Western European or right. things like toothpaste, you
right?
know?
And like my aunt's pen is on my uncle's table.
All that, right?
Yeah.
Make up a word for aspirin. The Klingon word for aspirin means coward's medicine. Anyway, coward's medicine is aspirin. Yeah. The Klingon speaking community loved it. What the reaction was, great, because now I can talk about everyday things. Before I can only talk about life on a spaceship.
So I imagine.
I don't know if that answered the question or not.
I don't either, but it was great. It was great. So I imagine there's like disagreements about, like, you know, for words that you haven't made up, and the fans kind of argue over stuff. Do they defer to you if there's an argument?
Yeah. They decided. I did not. They decided that I'm the sole source. I'm the Klingon Academy.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
No one will make up a new word, okay? They might suggest, but no one will make up a new word. I have to do that. And every year, twice a year, because there's a big convention in the US in the summertime and in Germany in November, except neither one's happening this year. The US one was all virtual. The German one, I don't know what they're doing. So they'll send me a list of suggestions. So I make up new words, and during the year, you know, people ask me for things too. And every once in a while, they'll have grammatical things. Is this the right way to do it grammatically? Is that the right way to do it grammatically? And I'm supposed to settle those. And it's interesting because when I made up the language initially for the film, like I said, I didn't know anyone was going to speak it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of stuff I didn't think through quite as well as I should have. And I would have done a little differently had I known.
If you'd known it was going to have this life.
With what I had there. So there's all kinds of interesting things going on in Klingon that I wouldn't have anticipated.
That's fascinating. Okay, I'm going to turn back to the audience question. So Lenore, I guess she heard your bio and wonders if there are elements of Native American languages in Klingon.
Not on purpose. When the when I first did the Klingon, which was 1984, at the time, all we knew about Klingons is what we'd seen in the original TV show, the one from the 60s, and what I read in the script for Star Trek III. So what we knew about the Klingons is that those people are mean and terrible and awful, and you wouldn't want to get near one. So I went out of my way to make sure that their language didn't sound like any particular language on Earth, because if it sounded like, say, Thai, then I have everyone in Thailand mad at me because the language of these bad guys resemble theirs and stuff. And I particularly avoided making it sound like the language that I'd worked on, the one particular language that I wrote my dissertation about. Now the people, when the language was dead when I worked on it, the last speaker of that language died in 1930. So I was working with old field notes from an anthropologist and missionary notes and things like that. But that doesn't mean that the people were dead. There was still a lot of members of the tribe, of the group. And they've gotten themselves organized like everybody else these days. And they've got some land and resurrecting things and so on and so forth. And they've got a website. So I found out about this and looked on their website. And on their website, it talks about their culture and their history and their language. And when they talk about the language, they mention me, that what I did is how I wrote a grammar of their language and so on. And then they go on to say that this guy, Marc Okrand, who worked on their language, also developed Klingon for Star Trek, and it's based on our language.
Wow.
And I go, oh, I didn't know that. Actually, what they say is we'd like to think that our language influenced it or something like that. And then some years after that, they invited me to give a talk about my work on their language and what that was all about and how that relates to Klingon. I said, oh my God, because it doesn't. I went out of my way that it didn't resemble it. But I thought about it. And in fact, there's a lot of connections, but they're not words, they're not sounds, they're not grammatical features. It's my approach to the language, because when I worked on the Indian language, I was dealing with a language that had zero speakers. Mm-hmm. When I worked on Klingon originally, I was working on a language with zero speakers, right? And both of them were just language fragments at the beginning and so on. So there's a lot of my general approach to how to describe the language, how to think about it, is very, very parallel.
Interesting. So the process that
was a connection, but there's no connection in terms of specific words or anything, except one suffix. There's one suffix I took out of that language and put into Klingon. It sounds the same and means the same thing. But other than that, there's nothing. And in fact, somebody in the Netherlands did a study comparing the two languages, the Indian language and Klingon, to see if there was some kind of crossover. And he said, nah, except for some very general things, there's nothing. That guy didn't even catch the suffix.
Shows him. It shows what he knows. Okay, so you have several folks in the audience who are interested to hear more about the grammar and whether or not you had a language group that inspired the grammatical base. This one Mike indicates that some Semitic languages don't use to be, at least not in the present tense.
Right, right.
And others want to know about conjugations and just more about the grammar.
Yeah, well, the instructions that I got, my marching orders, so to speak, to make up the languages. This is an alien language, all right? It's not a language from any place on Earth. So I'm thinking, okay, if it's an alien language, what does that mean? In terms of the sounds, it had to sound like nothing, partly because of what I just said. It shouldn't resemble any language on Earth for the reasons I said, but also it should just be weird in some way and should feel weird. Languages are very patterned. And it's very, if you say all languages do X, you might get yourself in a little bit of trouble, but languages tend to do things, and certain sounds tend to go together in a language, and certain sounds tend not to be together in a language, things like that. So in picking the sounds for Klingon, I violated those rules, and I put sounds together that are all perfectly good human language sounds, but they should not belong in the same language. Okay, so it sounds a little funny because of that, not because of any individual sound. So that was my approach to the phonology. Plus, I had to base it on, there's a teeny tiny bit of Klingon in the very first Star Trek movie that I did not do. There's maybe 7-8 lines that were done by a guy named John Polville and James Doohan, who the actor who played Scotty. They made up those lines. So I had to incorporate that. For the grammar, it's the same thing. There's certain things that languages tend to do and tend not to do. So for example, basic word order of a language, in a simple sentence, subject, verb, and object, dogs bite people, right? Dogs is the subject, but you didn't know you're gonna have a grammar lesson. Dogs is the subject, bite is the verb, people is the object. If you're gonna say those, they have to come in some order or other. Right. In any language. You can't say all three things at the same time. I mean, there's all kinds of rules and theme and variation and stuff, but you can't say them at the same time. And there's a basic order in every language, although you can violate it for various reasons. And of those three things, subject, verb, and object, there's mathematically six possibilities. Subject, verb, object, object, subject, verb, 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 object, subject, whatever. There's six of them. And if you look at all the languages of the world, you'll find representatives of all six. But some are very, very common, like the one English has, subject and then verb and then object. Mm-hmm. And some are extremely rare. And the ones that are extremely rare are the ones where the object comes first. So that's what I picked for Klingon. Klingon is object and then verb and then subject. It's backwards from English. Mm-hmm. Not because it's backwards from English. That's not why I did it. I did it because that word order is, you know, among the rarest in the world, therefore it's the least earth-like some way, which is not to insult the speakers of those languages who really do that. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it was things like that. So choosing the grammar was based on making it not like anything, as opposed to, you know, Semitic languages do this or Romance languages do that.
Right.
Having said that, you can't help but be influenced by what you know.
Right.
So there's little bits of stuff that would creep in. And as soon as I realized I was doing something, my God, this is just like Navajo. Stop doing that. Hmm. Do something else. I wouldn't erase what I did, but I'd make sure I'd switch directions entirely.
Hmm. Interesting. So several people are asking about Klingon and sort of putting it in conversation with Esperanto as a universal and yet constructed international language. So there's one person wants to know if Klingon will overtake it. Another person wants to know if it will become a universal language. Do you have any opinions or predictions about Klingon?
Yeah. Well, I think Klingon has a better chance of becoming a universal language than Esperanto does, because Klingon is out there in the whole universe and Esperanto is not. But I don't know. I don't know. I thought after I did it, and even after it caught on, I thought there's a limited number of people who are going to do this and they're going to have a good time with it, and they do. But that's it. But suddenly in the last few years, there's an increased interest in the language. I don't know if that's because there's new Star Trek things on TV or what it is, but there's a lot more. And I thought I knew everybody in the whole world who spoke Klingon well. That's no longer true. People keep popping up. Where did that person come from? You know. So there's more and more people who are interested in it, more and more people who are doing it. It was never designed for international communication the way Esperanto was. The whole point of Esperanto is to be a means of communication among people who otherwise have nothing in common. Mm-hmm. So Esperanto is relatively easy to learn, at least it is if you know Western European languages. Klingon is not designed for those purposes at all. And there's still a lot of stuff that you can't say in Klingon because I haven't made up those words yet. So I don't know. I don't know that it's gonna ever, you know, take on the role of Esperanto. There's thousands and thousands of Esperanto speakers still. There are native speakers of Esperanto. There's no native speakers of Klingon. There almost was one once, but there's no native speakers of Klingon.
That sounds like a story. Okay, so Marty and Karen want to know what kind of pronunciation cues you give in the lexicon. They probably noticed how poorly I pronounced the word for spinner based on the English English alphabet.
Yeah. In the Klingon, when I wrote it out for the actors, and this was in the days, this is in the pre-word processor days or early word processor days, so I didn't have the ability to use characters other than the regular English, you know, 26 characters doubled because uppercase and lowercase. Mm-hmm. So I made up a spelling system where I use capital letters to indicate either non-English sounds. So when you see a big H, that's special. And then I would explain what that is. That's a, we explain what it is. Or or pronounce it in a, it's an English sound, but it pronounce it in a special way. So mm-hmm. a capital I is I, like in bid, it's never E, like, you know, or yeah, or I. So if you see Klingon written out in that romanization system that I use, this little capital letters are coming and going, and it looks like it's random or someone sat on the shift block or something or other. But that's not what it is. It's for, but it was done initially for the actors. Mm. Okay. And I also coached the actors, explain how to do it. And I got very used to it. So when I wrote the dictionary, I just kept it. It's not a good system. It's a very dumb way to make a spelling system. But they're Klingons. They're tough. They can cope. They can do it. I don't use the IPA, the International Phonetic Alphabet, because I didn't assume that all the actors knew it. And I certainly didn't assume that all the readers of the dictionary would know it. When I work with the actors, then I describe things very carefully. But for the book, which was not for not for phoneticians or linguists so much as it was for initially anyway, for Star Trek fans, it's kind of, you know, the Berlitz kind of way of explaining sounds. It's like this, but not quite, or something like that.
So Esther wants to know if you're working with Klingon right now. What kind of projects are you working on in Klingon now?
For Klingon, the only projects I'm working on are ones for the fans, ones for the Klingon speaking community. There are right now three Star Trek TV shows on the air. One of them is called Star Trek Discovery. It's now in its third season. Today was a new episode. The first year was the plot was heavy into Klingons. There was lots of Klingons and lots of Klingon language. I did not work on that. Okay. It's my language, it's my words, it's my grammar, but somebody else did all the translation for that. And the person, actually two people did it, and both of them are superb speakers of Klingon, and they did a great job. And I'm pleased, I don't feel jealous, I don't feel left out, I feel kind of honored that what I did is good enough that somebody else could do it.
Right.
And in fact, for that one, for the first season of Discovery, if you saw, in the US, it's on something called CBS All Access, and in Canada, it's on something or other. But everywhere else in the world, it's on Netflix. So if you happen to catch the first season of Discovery on Netflix, you can choose what language you want your subtitles in. And one of the choices was Klingon. The whole show was subtitled in Klingon by somebody else. That was, you know, that was a third person who did that. So there's Klingon in all these shows that I haven't done at all. Having said that, I have done some other stuff for Discovery, but not Klingon, other languages.
Okay.
If I'm working on something now, I'm not allowed to tell you. I'm sorry.
That's fair. So I understand. So Ronnie Gold says that I should ask you to tell the story of the actor who recited his lines in the wrong accent.
I know exactly what that is. In Star Trek III, the main character is a guy named Krug. He's played by Christopher Lloyd, who played Doc Brown in Back to the Future, that guy. Mm-hmm. And there's a scene where there's another, he's on a Klingon ship commanding the ship, and there's a Federation ship out there somewhere, and he tells the gunner to shoot at that Federation ship, but don't destroy it. I don't want you to destroy it. I want you to aim at the engine only. Okay? So he says something like, "Dosh your bush," pay attention to the target should be. Jontak nech. Jontak means engine. Nech means only. Okay. So he says to the gunner, "Jontak nech." So we're going to film the scene. Okay. Get ready. And the director was Leonard Nimoy. So Mr. Spock was my boss, right? That was, I never was sure whether or not to put that on a resume. So he says, okay, action. And Christopher Lloyd says, da 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 da. Jontane, like that. Leonard Nimoy yells, "Cut! You're supposed to be talking Klingon, not French. Do it again." Yeah, there was while we were filming, there was a lot of concern about the language. You know, initially, after every take, you know, the director Nimoy would check with the camera person, was that okay? And if it was okay, he'd say fine. or he'd say, no, the microphone made a shadow or something. Check with the sound person. And when there was Klingon in it, he would check with me. And I had to say whether it was okay or not. And if it was okay, I said, good. And if it was not okay, I'd say, no. I learned not to give that second answer very often, because then they'd have to shoot it over again and they would get angry because it costs money. So at the time, since nobody had heard this language except for me, if the actor goofed, but it still sounded like Klingon, I'd say, fine. So if the actor said toe and he should have said two, I'd say, no, that's good. That's good. I make myself a note. That word is now toe. We can cross out the two. So it changed. The language changed as a result of movie making. In fact, there was one time where the same thing, Christopher Lloyd, right after that scene I just told you about, was Joe Tatnech. He got it out right eventually. The gunner didn't listen, and the gunner blew up the ship, and Krug is angry. Okay, so he kills the gunner, right? He kills his crewman. And then one of the other Klingons says to Krug, says, my lord, they always called him my lord, my lord. And Krug is still angry, and he swings around, and the guy's name is that he's talking to is Torg. And he says, say the wrong thing, Torg, or I'll kill you too. He says that in English. But right before we shot the scene, he said to me, how do you say Torg in Klingon? And I thought about it. I didn't make up any of the character names, but I thought about it. So Krug in Klingon is Krug, and Torg was Dorg, Dorg, like that. He says, okay. I said, say Dorg. All right. So da-da-da, he swings around, say the wrong thing, Dorg, or I'll kill you too. Nimoy yells, cut. Why are you calling my Klingon a dork? Christopher Lloyd says, Mark told me to. Nimoy says, Mark, what's the matter with Torg? I said, no, Torg is fine. Torg is okay. Shoot it again. So we shoot it again. And when it's all done, Christopher Lloyd comes to me and says, oh, I'm so sorry. I got you in trouble with the director. I said, no, it's fine. Don't worry.
The bus. Okay.
He said, but did you notice? I didn't say Torg. I said Torg. I said it in Klingon. And if you see the movie, you can hear that.
That is amazing. I'm going to have to watch the movie again now. I'm having so much fun. We are really running short on time. So I'm going to ask one that I think is going to be a quick answer. Tom is wondering if Klingons curse.
Yes. They're very good at it.
Seems like they would be. That seems like culturally.
Yes, there's I don't know, half a dozen or 10 words in the dictionary that are translated the way you do cursing in comic books, because I wanted to make sure the book was published.
Nice. So we're at our time, and I want to be respectful of your time and everyone here. It has been so wonderful getting the chance to speak with you again. I feel I got extra because we got the prep time, and I just am so grateful to be able to do this. And this is actually one of my very last events for the museum. I'm moving on, and I'm so glad to be able to go out on this because it was so much fun. So thank you for that. And thank you, all of you who are watching, for being here with us. We do have a couple of little extras for you. If you are interested in exploring some more unexpected Klingon, you can check out the links that are in the chat. You will also find a link to the Klingon Language Institute where you can start learning Klingon. And I do want to remind you to please fill out the survey that you will be directed to at the end. And Mark, is your book still available? Can people go buy your book?
Yeah, go buy
his book, guys.
But online you can buy it. Amazon.
Go get the book. So there's some links now of Klingon and Hamlet in Klingon, Klingon on the Big Bang Theory, Klingon on Frasier, the Klingon Language Institute. So thank you all for joining us for this special members only and VIP event with Marc Okrand and me. I'm Tracy Guy Decker, and thanks a lot. We'll hang out for a little while so you can grab the links for the chat. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Bye-bye.